begin with saying that it is Monday afternoon of August 15th, and I am speaking with Mr. William Fletcher of Jefferson, or Jackson County?
Jackson County, Georgia, right.
Mr. Fletcher, would you tell me a little of your experiences during the World War II era?
Well, when the war broke out, I decided that I wanted to be a pilot in the Air Force, but I only had a high school education, and at that time it required 2 years of college or the equivalency. And I started, I was in Augusta, that's where I was raised, and I started to night school down there with a group of fellows like myself, and to try to prepare to pass the equivalency exam. And just about the very time we finished up this course in night school, the Air Force dropped the requirements to a high school education. So I immediately signed up for the aviation cadet training. And at that particular time, they were filled up. And so they enlisted me as a private unassigned. And I remained at home and drew $30 a month pay. And then when they had openings out at Maxwell Field, Montgomery, Alabama, for pre-flight training, they inducted us into the aviation cadets. And of course, there were seven of us boys that knew each other real well, grew up together, high school together and all, in Augusta, that left at the same time and went to Montgomery and Maxwell Field and did our pre-flight training. And then we went to Lakeland, Florida for primary training, and then up to Sumter, South Carolina, Shawfield for basic training. And there we kind of split up. I went to Turner Field at Albany, Georgia into twin engine training, and some of the other fellows, they went to single engine training. And I received my commission in wings at Turner Field in March of 43. And then I was assigned to Sebring, Florida for B-17 training. And after, I don't remember, 2 or 3 months at Sebring, I was assigned to Moses Lake, Washington. And there I was assigned a crew and started flight training with them. And we also went to Walla Walla, Washington and trained there in landings or whatever and taking the crew out to the gunnery range for gunnery practice.
And how much time total is this in training?
Well, from it was about a year total training. I don't really remember.
That's about
it. And when we finished training in the out in Washington State, they gave me an airplane, or I signed for one, a B-17, and we started overseas. And went by way of, I forget the field now we landed at in Wyoming. And then we went to Grand Island, Nebraska. And that was a staging area where they gave us all of our overseas equipment, sheep line flying gear and chemical warfare gear and guns and this, that, and the other. And then we went to Bangor, Maine, and then to Goose Bay, Labrador, then to Blue West One in Greenland, then to Reykjavik, Iceland, then to Prestwick, Scotland, and then on into England. And I wound up at the 100th Bomb Group. And it's there's been a lot written about the 100th Bomb Group. I was the aircraft commander of the plane that we named Fletcher's Castoria. And there were nine other men on the crew. And we did all of our combat flying out of Thorpe Abbott's, the 100th Bomb Group field at Thorpe Abbott's, England. And on our 20th mission, our regular plane, Fletcher's Castoria, was not in flying condition, was having some repairs done on it, and so we were assigned a spare aircraft, which turned out to be not be in flying condition also. We lost three engines due to mechanical failure, and were out over the North Sea when the third engine quit, and we had, at that time, we had 120 miles of to go to get to England, and only about 60 miles an hour ground speed, and I knew we couldn't make it. It was February, and the life expectancy in the North Sea at that time is not very high, and so I elected to turn and go back, and I belly landed in Holland. And to back up just a little bit, right after our seventh mission, I was checking out a new crew at Thorpe Abbott's in Fletcher's Castoria number one. And we had been shooting landings, and we were coming in. I'd made a couple of landings and had this new pilot at the controls coming in, and everything looked absolutely perfect to me. But all of a sudden we were close to the ground. The right wing dropped out from under us, and when it did, I hit the throttles and knocked them all the way forward and kicked left rudder to try to pick the wing up. But we hit on the right wheel, and the number three and four props were torn up, and the right wing tip was bent somewhat. And the engines caught at the same instant we hit on that wheel, and the plane bounced. We went back up in the air a ways, and the plane rolled over on the left wing, and that caught the ground, and we went somersaulted down the field, hitting on the left wing, the nose, and the tail, and it completely destroyed the aircraft. And the only way we managed to get out of it was that it did not catch fire. And after I got out of the plane, I started looking for the bombardier navigator who were in the nose when we hit, and the nose was completely torn up. And I didn't see him in the wreckage right at the immediate area, and so I ran back up the field where we had first hit, and there was wreckage strewn all down the field, and I didn't find him there. And when I got back to the plane, the main part of it, I heard a groan and saw this part of this a leg sticking out from under one of the engines that was completely torn out of the wing of the plane. And I managed to pick that engine up with a lot of help from the good Lord, and got the man out from under it and moved him out far enough so that the plane did catch on fire, then he'd be safe. And I went back to get the second man out from under the engine, and an enlisted man who was on the ground had run up and asked if he could help do anything, and I told him to get the man out from under the engine when I picked it up, which he did. And those two officers were pretty badly injured, but the rest of us got out with more or less minor injuries. We were hospitalized overnight, and then went back to on flight duty. And then to pick up now after where we when we landed in belly landed in Holland, wheels up landing. I stayed. Three of the other crew members stayed with me to set the plane on fire, and then we started running. We were out in the middle of a big flat field, and out of the corner of my eye I could see a man, a German, on a bicycle pedaling towards us as fast as he could pedal. And he got, 500, 600 yards from us. I saw him get off the bicycle and get down on one knee. And he fired a round at us with his rifle, and I heard the bullet go by, and so I just hit the ground, and I knew it was time to give up. I'd rather be a live coward and fight another day than be a dead hero. But anyway, four of my crew members did evade for several days, but they were all eventually captured by the Germans. Of course, the Germans knew that there were 10 people on the crew, and they had only picked up six of us to at the very beginning, and so they were very diligently looking for the other four crew members.
And what section had you gone down over?
We went down between Harlem and Amsterdam. Some of the Dutch people took photographs of the aircraft sitting out in the field there where we'd set fire to it. And shortly after the war, one of the guys got in touch with us and sent us, he sent some of the pictures to the 8th Air Force, I think, because there's a picture of the plane in Roger Freeman's history of the 8th Air Force. And then we got in touch with this Dutchman, and he sent us copies of the pictures. And since that time, this picture also appeared in a German newspaper that somebody had a copy of it in when I was in prison camp and cut the picture out and gave it to me, and I still have that picture in a scrapbook. But last October, I had a phone call one afternoon, and my wife actually answered the phone, and this gentleman started asking her questions about me and if I was a B-17 pilot and if I'd been a prisoner and so forth. And she finally put me on the phone, and it turned out to be Dutchman that is now living in California, and his brother-in-law had actually seen me, had been out in the field working and saw us as we came in and made the landing, and they had been looking for me for 50 years to give me some photographs and of the plane and some other information that they'd dug up through the Air Force. And Van Loon, who was and his brother, were the ones that saw us land, and he has written an eyewitness account of that last few minutes as we came in to land, and they've even sent topographical maps to show the exact flight of the path of the plane as it went down.
Would you mind if I photocopied that, please?
No, you can. And fortunately, I've been corresponding with these people out in California quite a bit, calling on the phone and whatnot. And I got together, organized a reunion between all but one of the surviving crew members and these two Dutch families. And we met up in Cleveland, Ohio in June of this year, and had a great time. They're wonderful people, and I think they really enjoyed being with us and hearing some of our tales about the war.
Why'd you pick Cleveland?
Well, there's a restaurant there that's the 100th Bomb Group restaurant. And it was originated by a guy that had been in the 100th Bomb Group. and he had his own B-17 plus over 100 other aircraft, and he owned over 100 restaurants scattered all over the country. But I think that he has fallen into hard times and lost most of his aircraft through divorces and one thing and another, and most of the restaurants. But if you've never been in one of those restaurants that's named after a bomb group, a fighter squadron, a group, there's one down in Atlanta that's named after a fighter group. And they solicited pictures and memorabilia from all the people they could contact when they built these restaurants. And the walls up there at the Hunter's Bomb Group have a lot of pictures and whatnot of the Fletcher Castoria crew on the walls. I have a nephew, and he lives down in Atlanta that is into genealogy, and he became interested in the crew. He was watching TV one night, and they had a documentary on that BBC put out. It was called The Raid on Telemark, when we went to Norway and bombed the heavy water plant up there where the Germans were trying to develop an atomic bomb. And they quoted me in that documentary about the raid, and that just excited my nephew tremendously. And he started doing a lot of research, and he went out to Maxwell Field and went through the archives out there and dug up a lot of information, missing crew reports, and all just all. I have two loose leaf notebooks full of material and that he's dug up, and he's contacted a lot of people. He did most of the correspondence with the Dutchman that took the pictures, or gave us the first pictures of the plane. But of course, after we were captured by the Germans, we were locked up in a small jail in Harlem, I think it was, and was there for a couple of days. And then they transported us by train to Frankfurt, Germany, where they had a big interrogation center. And my memory is not too good about those days now. But we were at Frankfurt, I guess, 6-7 days, something like that. And the Germans, of course, hammered at us for several different times trying to get information, but they actually had more information about the Hunter's Bomb Group than I had, so I couldn't very well tell them anything. They knew right where my airplane was parked on the field, and who the commanding officer was, and all the squadron leaders, and the whole ball of wax. One thing that happened while I was there in Frankfurt, we were in a very small cell, just room enough for a cot and 3 or 4 feet between it and the wall to walk through. But there was a window in the cell, and of course the shutters on it were, the window's panes were painted over, or you couldn't see through them. I forget what they had done to them. But they had let me retain a little pocket knife that my mother had given me on my 21st birthday while I was out in Washington State. And these windows, they had the latch on them. They were hinged on either side and opened up from the middle. And the latch on them, they'd removed the handle, but the handle shaft was square and went in a square hole in the latch. And I worked a nail out. I may have used the point of my knife now, I don't remember which, but the latch was very loose, and I managed to turn it and open that window. And I would open it up occasionally and stand there and stare out at practically nothing. But one day I was standing in the window like that, and this roving German guard came right down beside the building, and I didn't see him till he stepped in front of the window. And when he looked and saw me with that window open, he was real startled, and he took off running. And I calmly locked the window back and laid down on the cot. And a few minutes, the I heard a key in the door, and the door flew open, and there was a sergeant, I guess, with this buck private, and he went over and he checked the window out and shook it and messed with it, and it was locked tight, and he really gave that buck private a hard time about it. And of course I was laying there on the cot looking stupid and everything, and just all I could do to keep from laughing at him. And after our stay in Frankfurt, they put us on trains, a whole bunch of us, they moved at one time, and put about, I think it was about 15 of us in one of those little cattle cars that they had, and they made us stay in one end of the cattle car, and they just had some hay thrown in, straw thrown in there for us to lay on. And they had two German guards in the other end, and they had a stove with them down in their end. We didn't have anything to heat us, except
that. What
type of beer was that? Huh? What this was in either the latter part of February, early March. Quite cold, snow on the ground, whatnot. And they took our shoes away from us, thinking that if we did manage to get away or something, we wouldn't be able to travel as well without our shoes. But at night, I would start easing over towards that stove to try to get warm, and I'd get as close to it as I could, just a little bit at a time. And one night there, I wound up, I was laying right up with the Germans, right beside one of them, and he went to sleep. And when he did, his submachine gun he had fell over on me, and I picked it up and looked at it, and decided it wasn't any percentage in trying to do anything as far as getting away at that point was concerned. The boxcar door was locked on the outside, and it would just cause a lot of bloodshed if I'd have bothered the German soldier. So I just punched him in the ribs and handed him the gun back and went on back to sleep. But it took us several days to get up to Barth, Germany, where the Stalag Luft 1 was. I remained in until the end of the war. At first, the camp was not too bad. We had pretty good quarters. I think they had been barracks for German soldiers at one time, and they were pretty well insulated. But still, the Germans didn't give us very much fuel, and we were cold a lot of the time. Didn't have a lot of clothing. Only had one little blanket. We used to, when it got real cold, we'd put newspapers and our socks and handkerchiefs that we had and any extra clothing on the bed, and then put the blanket over the top of them and to try to stay warm. And we had sufficient food for I don't know, maybe 7 months. I don't remember exactly. In that the Germans gave us Red Cross parcels about once a week, and these contained either a can of Spam or a can of corned beef and some powdered milk, some instant coffee, a pound of sugar, or sometimes some liver paste, some cigarettes, some C-ration cookies and a candy bar, chocolate bar, and there was some margarine in there that was so sorry we couldn't eat it when we was hungry. We used to punch holes in the can and throw them in the stoves, burn it to stay warm. But after a while they stopped giving us those food parcels, and they doled out the food that they supplied us by, we were supposed to get the same ration as a field ration for a German soldier, infantryman. And that was so many ounces of potato, kilos, and meat, barley, this, that, and the other, cabbage, per man, per week, or per day, or whatever. But they would figure that up. There was about 2,500 men in the part of the camp that I was in, over 10,000 in prisoners in it all together, and the majority of them were Eighth Air of United States flying personnel, either bombardiers, navigators, or pilots, all officers. And but for that 2,500 or so men that was in the part of the camp I was in, you know, they'd figure that was so many kilos of potatoes, so many kilos of cabbage, so on and so on for a certain period of time. And if they had some cabbage that was half rotten and some potatoes that were half rotten, that's what they'd bring us. And they'd say, well, you know, you do so many kilos and that's so many kilos. But of course, that if half of it was rotten, that cut our rations in half. And when we got down to that situation, we had one bowl of thin, watery soup with a little cabbage and kohlrabi or carrots or a little potato, whatever in it, but it was mostly water, and two thin slices of German bread per day. And that was what we survived on for 6 or 7 months. Over that period of time, I lost probably 30, 35 pounds. But we used to do everything we could to aggravate the Germans. We thought we could get by with some of the things I remember. There was the British were very adept at aggravating them. They one time there was several of them got together and they took cardboard from Red Cross parcels and they formed a tube out of it that was probably 6, 7, 8 inches in diameter and about 4 feet long. And then on either end of the tube they had a horn coming out that resembled an artillery range finder, really. And they took three broom handles and made a tripod out of it. And they got soot out of the chimney and mixed it with margarine and rubbed it in this cardboard and made it look like metal. And they mounted that thing on the tripod, and I happened to see them as they were performing. But they got in the barracks with it, and the barracks were built in a square. But they got in one barracks, I guess, with this contraption without the Germans seeing them. And then they would there was a guard tower right down at the corner where my barracks was. And they came out of the other barracks that across from us. One British boy came out and he looked all around like he didn't want anybody to see him, and he knew the guard was right up in the tower looking right at him. But he looked all around and he motioned for him back, you know. And these two other guys ran out there and they spent a lot of time setting that tripod up just right. And then one of them got on that thing and started looking down in it and turning it first one way and then the other. And then all of a sudden one of the other guys tap him on the shoulder and they fold that thing up and they'd run into another barracks and go out the other end and do the same thing. Well, it wasn't but about 10 minutes before the German goon squad came with their full field equipment, helmets, gas masks, canteens, fixed bayonets, guard dogs and everything else. Came looking for them to get that contraption away from them. But of course they got 10 days bread and water for it, but they didn't care. And one of the other things they did, I heard all this laughing and hollering and carrying on one day and went out and there was a whole crowd of, oh gosh, it must have been close to 100 of the Americans just jammed up in the crowd. And all of a sudden, I'd see this little guy, I don't guess he weighed 100 pounds, he'd come shooting up in the air out of the middle of all those people. And he'd go up and he'd wave at the guard in the tower and all this crazy antics. And they soon came in and broke that up. They didn't know what, if they, we had invented some sort of machine we was going to start throwing them over the fence with or what. But they just had four big husky men there with a blanket on each corner, and they'd count to three and jerk that blanket as hard as they could and send the guy up in the air. And they, we used to have, anytime anybody got out of the camp, which was not too frequently, they'd have an identity parade. And they had little ID cards about this big with a snapshot of us on it and a little bit of information. And they would they'd make us go all get out of the barracks and then file by a table with this German sitting there, and we'd give them that name, serial numbers. And they would go through the file and pull that card out. And they got through, if there's any cards left, they knew who had, was missing, you know. But one of the Germans set a box of those files down one day and turned his back. And one of the prisoners grabbed it and ran off with it. And they tore him up, burned him up. And that caused quite a bit of commotion. For a few days after that, some of the boys would, they'd make them up a box that looked like the one the German had those cards in, and they'd put some old stale bread in it or something, run out in the yard and look around like they didn't want anybody to see them, and dig a hole real quick and put a box in it and cover it up and walk off. And the Germans would be there scratching it up right quick. But there was also some tragic incidents. There were several of the boys that got killed. They are shot. There was, first few months, whenever there was a 8th Air Force air raid on, which if the planes came anywhere near us, we would all be out in the yard cheering them on. And the Germans finally decided they didn't like that and put the word out that we'd have to stay in the barracks. And they didn't have an air raid siren at the camp. There was one in the little town of Barth about 3 or 4 miles away, or maybe a little further than that. But one Sunday, one of the boys was going to go to church service and got ready, and the siren had gone off, and he didn't hear it. And he walked out the door of the barracks, which the doors were either end of the barracks. And he walked out the door and got out just a few steps and realized nobody was out in the yard, and turned to go back into barracks, and the guard up in the tower shot him through the head and killed him. And we had the compound I was in had a mess hall that had been, as I say, I think it was, I'm sure it was German troops in the, one time, but I worked in the mess hall some, in charge of the potato detail, seeing that the potatoes got peeled and everything. But the fence around the hall on one on the back side was probably the least guarded part of the fence in the camp, and they had a roving guard that used to walk it all the time. But one of the boys went out there one morning when it was real foggy and watched that guard and timed him, and to see how long it took him when he got from one end and went down and turned and came back. And he let him get all the way to the far end and started over the fence. And when he got on the opposite side from the camp, one of the wires that he stepped on slipped through in the staple and made a noise. And the German wheeled around and hollered, "Halt." And the boy put his hands up in the air and he shot him in the stomach, but he survived. And there was a few things like that. And of course we were on a constant threat of death. The Germans always saying that they'd never let us out of there alive. And we had reason to believe that if they had the opportunity, that's what would, they would certainly see to that. But and Hitler, I believe, put out an order for him to kill all of us, and then I believe Goebbels county man at the altar. And we had some, it was about six or eight Czechoslovakians that had been in the RAF. They were there in the camp to begin with, and they used to do all the cooking for us in the mess hall till it burned down. But they rounded them up there towards the end of the war and took them off, and they were killed. They were just machine gunned down when they got them out in the woods somewhere or whatever. And they, at one time, they made a registry of all the Americans and British that were Jewish from their dog tags. And of course, they were next on the list for extermination. So that was one of the toughest parts of it. Of course, I guess at the time I didn't pay too much attention to it. I guess I didn't have sense enough to. I always felt that Britain and the United States would eventually win the war, and that we'd get back home. It's most of the POWs too have developed a lot of health problems since then. So the rate of depression amongst them, I guess, is the highest of any section of our population. I know of the seven of us that left Augusta together, two of them committed suicide after the war. And I forgot to mention that all seven of us wanted to be pilots, and all seven of us made it through pilot school training, which was pretty good. And there was one of the guys killed in a mid-air collision in B-24 over England. Another one, he grew up just three blocks from me in B-25s and was killed in action. One of the guys finished 25 missions in England and got back to the States, and the rest of us POWs. So flying and over there was not a, it was a pretty hazardous occupation.
Can you tell me about the liberation of the camp?
Yes, because we could hear the Russians liberated us, because we were up towards the north there, and we were out on a little peninsula in the Baltic. And as the Russians began to, in their advance, they began to get close to the camp, we could hear the artillery and everything. And then the Germans started blowing everything up one day. When we got up the next morning, they were all gone. They took off. And they had a warehouse full of Red Cross parcels there that they said they didn't have. And they had looted those. They didn't take anything but the cigarettes and candy bars out of them and threw the rest of it on the ground. The Russian troops that came through to begin with were, they were really a rough-looking bunch. Some of us went up to the highway where they were going right through that area. And they, most of them were in, well, I guess 95% of them were in horse-drawn wagons. And they had two big perch-on horses, perch-ons hauling the wagon, two tied behind, eating the hay out of the back of the wagon. And there would be six or seven of them piled up in the hay. All of them had machine guns, most of them. And there were a lot of women in the bunch, real rough looking. characters. And about every, they were all drunk. And about every sixth or seventh wagon would be piled as high as they could pile it with this Bowles liqueur that's made in, I forget where it's made now, but you can buy it in the United States. Every now and then one of the Cossacks would come through on a horse, and he'd be so drunk that he could hardly sit on the horse, and kicking it in the ribs with his spurs every time he jumped. And occasional jeep came through, and it has left hand on the horn and just weaving everywhere. He didn't care whether he hit anybody or not. Saw a few trucks, American trucks, go through. But they were a rough-looking bunch, and they, as long as they were in the area, every night we'd hear random shots all through the little old town around up there. And there were several women that
excuse me, one moment.
I'm sorry. Your truck lights are on.
Oh, my gosh.
Is your truck locked?
It is. I'll have to go pause for a moment and get it. But it can handle it. It's got a full charge. So I'll take a break.
Well, go ahead.
Thank you, Prudence.
Cut it off.
I need my keys, so I'll get it, Prudence.
Cut it off and we'll pick back
up.
Sure? Yeah, yeah.
Let's pick back up in a moment.
All right.
Back up with Mr. William Fletcher. And we're rolling. And I had asked you about the liberation, and you had told me about some of the Russian troops.
Right.
And we'd gotten a little bit past that. Can you...
Well, I was talking about how tough those first troops that came through looked, and I was about to relate that several of the German women in the little town of Barth were so afraid of these people that they wheeled up the babies in carriages out in the fields there by the camp and killed the kids and themselves to keep the Russians from them having to be prisoners of the Russians or whatever. And when some of the regular troops came through, a guy that told the camp officials or officers, commanding officers, that he was a colonel, I think, turned out that he was just a sergeant in the Russian army, but our senior officers that told us not to leave the camp and just spread out over the countryside to stay there. And they still had the gates locked. And this Russian came up in a jeep, and he wanted to know why we hadn't been turned loose, liberated. And they argued with him a little bit, and he told them to open the gates. If they didn't open them, he was going to come back with a tank and open them up for us. But then they drove in. They went out and rounded up a bunch of Holstein milk cows in the area and drove them into camp so we'd have something to eat. And they treated us pretty good. And then KGB or whatever, some of the officials back in Russia decided that they... The 8th Air Force wanted to come in and to the little airfield at Barth and fly us out. And they were going to walk us back through Russia to the Black Sea, 1,000 miles or so, whatever. And I think the intentions were, I don't have any proof of it, but they had the cream of the United States Air Force. About 10,000 of us, and I think that their intentions were that not many of us were going to survive that march, because they, with all the trouble we had with the Russians after the war, their post-war, some of them were figuring, they were already planning it, I guess. It was in their strategy, and they figured that they knew we had the best darn Air Force that had ever been assembled. And so they figured if they could get rid of 10,000 pilots, they'd be that much better off.
What changed their minds
on March?
I guess if the U.S. government finally put enough pressure on them that they decided to let them fly us out, and they sent B-17s in and put about 20 of us, I think, on a plane and flew us down to France, Camp Lucky Strike. And then from there, we went to Le Havre, but most of them did, and caught boats out to, not to Le Havre, yeah, caught boats out to the United States. They gave me the option of going back to my base and visiting, and I decided to do that. And, I had been dating an English girl, and I renewed that acquaintance and got married before I left England. And it was quite some while, several months before she was able to get over here. But
what was her maiden name?
Stally, Elsie Stally. And she's still putting up with me. Let's see. When we were liberated, our camp commanders did give us permission to go out on this peninsula that the camp was on and wander around and everything. And I saw some fish traps that the Germans had out in the water, and they were quite large traps, and they were at the end of a net fence that went from the bank out to the trap, so that any fish that came down alongside the bank there would hit that net, and they would go out, follow it out, and go in the trap. And the water was quite cold, but I decided I was going to find out if there was any fish there in the traps. And so I pulled off my clothes and tried to get somebody to go help me. None of them would, but I went out and managed to get a couple of these traps up and got some nice big fish out of them, and went back to the camp and cooked those up. So we had a good feast on fish there. And that was about it. Well, they used to dig a lot of tunnels there in the camp. None of them were ever successful.
How could you dig?
I used tin cans. Uh-huh. So one of a lot of the boys didn't get suffocated or killed in those tunnels because the ground was quite sandy, and they didn't dig them very big. But the barracks that I was in was very close to the fence, and on the opposite side of the fence was just a big open field. And the Germans had such a good security system there that they knew these tunnels were dug. Sometimes they would dig them, and they would get all the way under the fence, and then they'd decide the ones that were in on the tunnel were going to go out on a certain night, you know, and the Germans would come in that morning and cave them in. I think they had a lot of men there we thought were Americans, they had been Americans more or less. But we had one guy in the barracks that was from the Milwaukee area, I believe, spoke fluent German. His parents were old country Germans, I think. But they had young men like that they forced them back to Germany and into the German armed forces by threatening their family members that were still in Germany. And of course, they were raised here in this country. They had the same idioms that we had, and they knew the baseball teams, the football teams, and all that junk. And they'd get the scores, the current scores on the radio. And so we couldn't tell them, they'd put them in an American uniform. We couldn't tell who they were. And I think that they have got a lot of information that through them. And they'd crawl under the barracks at night and listen to conversations, some of them. And they had these dogs that were trained to, they'd put them under the barracks, and if they smelt any fresh dirt, they'd let them know it. Things of that kind. So the most successful escape from the camp happened when they were building on a new barracks. Or maybe it was two. And some of the boys found a real long board in the attic of their barracks. And the fence, barbed wire fences, were double. And I mean, there were two fences about 6 feet, 8 feet apart. And they had tangled barbed wire down in between them. But these boys found out that board was long enough that they could lean it up against the fence on the inside, and then run up it, and then the board would fall across the two fences, and then jump off, and it'd drop back down, and another one would run over, cross over, and they got by doing that for several nights. I don't remember how many got out, but two or three or four would go at a time, and they'd hide, and they'd watch the changing of the guard. And they had things timed right so they could get to these barracks that they were building that had no fence around them. And they'd stay there till dark and then get out and start walking. But I think all of them got caught somewhere in Germany, and a lot of times the civilians would darn near beat them to death before they got back in military hands.
Would you quiz new arrivals in any way?
I think they did, but you know, there'd be quite a few of them dumped on in the camp at any one time, and but they, I think that the word was out that if we, you know, somebody came in there that nobody could recognize or decide, you know, where he'd been or what outfit he belonged to or something, they'd begin to get suspicious of him.
Well, so how much, and would you, could you spell the name of that camp for me?
Yes, it was Stalag, Stalag, Luft, L-U-F-T, one.
Luft, yeah. What?
One, number one, mm-hmm. Stalag Luft one.
And you were there from how long total?
Well, I went down on February the 21st, 1944. And of course, it was about the 6th of May, 45, when we were liberated. About 15 months.
Do you recall when the Allies invaded Europe?
Oh, yeah.
Did you have any...
We had a clandestine radio, and you knew that. We knew it before the Germans did, almost.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they had a radio head that we got news on all the time. One of the good things. Well, one of the other funny things that went on, there were a lot of boys there that had been in some of the big bands, Dorsey, Benny Goodman, and whatnot, and the Red Cross the YMCA had sent in a bunch of musical instruments and for entertainment, and they formed a nice orchestra. And before our mess hall burned down, every night, for our supper meal, when we had Red Cross parcels, the Czechs, you know, would cook a meal, and we'd go in and sit down at the table, and we had an orchestra playing for us every night. And I don't know whether you've ever heard Spike Jones' recording of In the Fuhrer's Face, but they used to play that occasionally, you know, and there would be several Germans standing around in there watching us, and we'd all be clapping and hollering. They'd be just laughing and grinning too, you know, until they found out what the song was all about, and then they couldn't play In the Fuhrer's Face anymore. That they and we had some of the boys put on some plays for us. The one I remember most was The Man Who Came to Dinner. They did quite well in those things. And then there were 16 of us in one room. Had 8 double-deck bunks in there. And then there was just room enough for a fair-sized table. But most of us had to stay in the bunks. You know, there wasn't more room enough for everybody to move around at one time.
Were you able to send correspondence at all while you were a prisoner of war?
Got some. They had these little... printed up forms that you could get, letter forms that kind of like the V-mail, if you know anything about V-mail, and They'd let us write, I don't know, once a week or something like that. A lot of times it didn't get through, and then our families were supposed to be able to get a parcel to us frequently, but the government made arrangements with tobacco companies that they could send us, I forget how many packages of cigarettes it was. It was several cartons or a box of cigars or something in a very reasonable price, you know, very low price. And we got some parcels early in the stay, and then the Germans cut those off. That they had them stored. There was several that came to my home address after the war, where the troops found them over there in this warehouse and then sent them on back. We used to use cigarettes for currency, poker games, buy chocolate bars with them. And this guy that I was talking about from Milwaukee that spoke fluent German used to trade with one of the German guards at night. The guard would come to the latrine window on the inside of the barracks where the ones in the tower couldn't see him. He'd know the shutters on the window. And and close these shutters, and iron would go across them from over them. But on one of the shutters on our window had a little knot in it. And I worked that knot out, and it had a hole about an inch in diameter there. And I took the lid out of a can of instant coffee and worked a little nail out of the wall from somewhere and drove it through that lid and had it hanging over that hole, just a swinging closure for it. And I took that little pocket knife I mentioned and cut the side of the shutter next to the building, cut it out so that I could get my head up against the shutter and look right down the side of the barracks. I did that on either side. And I used to go up and look out every once in a while, but I'd always look down both sides of the barracks, and I'd look through the crack of those shutters down at the bottom. But one night I saw this roommate, his name was Wood, and he walked over to the window there and raised that tin lid up and stuck his eye up against the shutter, and when he did, he just froze. And that tin lid came loose from his finger and started swinging back and forth like a pendulum on that nail. And he turned around, he was right white looking, and I said, "What's the matter with you, Wood?" He pointed at the window and he tried to speak, and he couldn't make a sound. And I walked over and looked through the crack at the bottom of the window, and I could see these big black German boots, the toes of these big black German boots right there. And that German had his eye against the shutter when old Wood pulled that thing up and stuck his eye. The eyeballs wasn't 2 inches apart. But he never did try to look out the window after that.
Let me ask you about the time after your release. Again, you mentioned you married a British woman.
Right.
How did you meet your wife? Before or after you were
Before I went down, pretty early. After I got to England, the big place to stay and eat a lot for a lot of the airmen in London was the Regent Palace Hotel. And I was, all the officers of the crew was, the four of us were in there having supper one night, and this pretty little girl waited on us, and I whistled a little bit of something, and anyway, wound up that she had an older sister that worked there too, and I'd asked her for a date, and she was pretty shy, and wasn't going to date me, but her sister finally decided that she'd go along and date one of the other crew members, my co-pilot. And so that's the way we got started dating. And then, as I say, after I got liberated, I decided to go back to England and visit the group and the base, and then I went to London and renewed my acquaintance with the LC, and I was supposed to go to be at Southampton at a certain date to get a boat home, and I went down to Southampton and stayed there a couple of days, and there wasn't any boat ready to go, and nobody knew when there was going to be one, and so I would go back to London and hang around three or four more days and then go back to Southampton, and that happened three or four times, and it wound up I stayed in London for a couple of months. And when I finally got down to Southampton one day, they said, "Man, where you been?" I said, "This is the last boat going over." It was a great experience, worth $10 million for the first one and not worth a nickel for the second one.
Let me ask you just a couple of things. If I tossed out names and dates, can you tell me what you remember about December 7th, 41? Where were you when Pearl Harbor?
Yeah. I was at home in Augusta, and there was a drugstore downtown in Augusta that a bunch of us teenagers used to hang out in. And some of the guys belonged to the National Guard. And we went down, we were interested in what the situation. But there was some of us down at this drugstore, and these boys in the National Guard were kind of laughing, you know, and saying, "Well, y'all going to get drafted." And we in the National Guard, we're going to stay home. And, of course, they were the first ones to go after the dust settled a little bit. And I remember December the 7th very well.
Where was your home in Augusta?
I lived at 2473 McDowell Street. And it's up on, they call it the Hill. It is a pretty much of a hill from downtown Augusta. What is now the Augusta College, our property backed up to that Augusta, it was then the Augusta Arsenal, United States Arsenal, had been since the Civil War, I think. And I was working there as a small arms repairman when I went in the Air Force. And the Germans knew that. They had that on that little ID card they had in the prison camp. But they picked that up from a little thing they put in the Augusta paper about me when I went enlisted. It says, well, I guess maybe it was after I'd been commissioned, because it said Lieutenant Fletcher can repair his own guns, and well, it's a little bit about me working there, you know.
And the Germans got that.
Oh, yeah, some of their sympathizers over here, you know, they'd spend all their time clipping stuff out of newspapers and mailing them to Germany. That's where they got a lot of their information. Sure did. But
we don't think about German sympathizers during the war very much. I'm sure they had in
Oh, yeah. They had a lot of them over here, really. They even had Bund, you know.
The Bund we've heard of.
Yeah. It was pretty active.
Can you tell me some of the 50 years since those days, since how your career has gone and
well, as I mentioned, I only had a high school education, and I intended staying in the Air Force as a career. And I went to, spent several days, I was a reserve officer, and I wanted a regular commission, and I spent several days down at Fulton McPherson in Atlanta, at one time taking exams to qualify for commission in the regular Air Force, and I passed those exams, but I never did hear anything on it, and I had opted to go back to Turner Field after I got back from overseas and was stationed there, and then they closed it down. I moved over to Warner Robins, and I wasn't doing a whole lot. And I, the post-war shake-up and everything, I decided, and they took a lot of the, those reserve officers that wanted to stay in and busted them down, the master sergeants or whatnot. And so I